speaker of the day, Professor Madhavi Latha. So Professor Madhavi Latha is a full professor at Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. And she obtained her PhD from Indian Institute of Technology, Madras. And her research specializations include geosynthetics, earthquake geotechnical engineering, and rock engineering. So she has published more than 150 technical papers in international and national journals and conferences. And Professor Madhavi Latha is a geotechnical consultant for world's highest railway bridge being constructed at Jammu. She is the member of ISSMG Technical Committee on Soil Structure Interaction and Retaining Walls, and also geomechanics from micro to macro. And she is also a technical committee member on soil reinforcement of International Geosynthetic Society. So currently, she is the editor-in-chief of Indian Geotechnical Journal and associate editor of Geotextiles and Geomembranes. She received Best Woman Researchers in Geotechnical Engineering Award from IGS year 2020. So with this very brief introduction, it's my pleasure to welcome Professor G. Madhavi Latha and invite her to deliver her lecture. It's over to you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, Amarnath, for your introduction. And I'm very delighted to be here. And it feels like home when I see Sirish and Amarnath in the, you know, as chair and vice chair, because they have been working in this area of geosynths for a long time and they are like close associates. I will try to share my screen now. Can you see my screen?
Not yet, ma'am.
Okay. Let me show you. Can you see it now?
Yes.
Yeah, it's coming up. Thank you. Yeah.
Okay. So, good afternoon and good morning to everyone. I'm Professor Madhavi from IASC. I've been working in the area of geosynths for past 25 years. And to be like very specific, 25 years back in 1995, when I joined IIT Madras for my PhD, first time my supervisor, Professor Rajgopal, asked me to learn about geosynths, and that would be my PhD topic. So from that time, I have been working in this particular topic. It's one of the very fascinating subjects of soil reinforcement. And 20 minutes is a very short time, as Sirish already pointed out, but I would try to just present some of the interesting and most pressing aspects of my research on geosynths, along with some introduction here and there. And their applications for transportation, geotechnical engineering. So this would be the outline of my presentation, a brief introduction on geosynths and geosynth supported embankments, geosynth faced retaining walls, geosynth faced reinforced unpaved roads, and some future directions in this particular area. And if you look back and see the history of geosynths, they're not very old. Their inception was around in 1979 by US Army Corps of Engineers. And their main application when they were invented was transportation geotechnical engineering. Because these engineers from US Army, they were trying to move their military vehicles in a very short notice from one place to other place. And they don't have proper road connectivity and they have to go through lands which are very soft. In that situation, they have come up with this idea of creating this network of cells into which soil, native soil, is poured and military vehicles can be moved very easily. So if you see the slide on the screen, to the right side of you, you see a military man filling these cells with the very native soil, which is kind of clay filled with boulders and clay and some cohesionless particles and so on. So there is no limitation on the type of soil or material we can use in geocells. That was the advantage. And the another advantage is these cells can be constructed in no time and they can be filled with native soil and you can get the work done without any waiting time for stopping the traffic or anything. So this became very attractive form of soil reinforcement, particularly for transportation applications. And initially, the cells were in the form of squares or triangles. There were different types of forms, and they evolved to be honeycomb type of shape over the time. The reason for honeycomb perfectly fitting into the solution is because, as proved by many mathematicians, the honeycomb shape has the capacity to hold maximum volume with minimum perimeter. This is one of the greatest works of old mathematicians, and very recently also it is proved again. So because of that, we can actually use less material of geosynthetic outlayer to construct geocells, and then fill soil and use that to fill maximum soil, and with minimum amount of geocentric material, get the maximum benefit out of this network of cells. So to be very brief, geocells have evolved into honeycomb-shaped cells made of high-density polymeric materials with lot of variations, including the friction on their surfaces and also the porous structure to allow drainage through their pockets and all that. You can see the modern form of geocells on the screen. They come in a collapsed form and they can be expanded in the field to be filled with soil and used for many different applications, and in particular for transportation applications. And the mechanism of their reinforcement is very simple but very complicated at the same time, because you use a network of cells. So these cells are filled with soil, and there is always this internal pressure which is pushing these walls of geocell. And then because of that internal confinement, the soil is always in a state of, you know, a kind of confining stress condition. At the same time, there is also a pushing from the adjacent cells, which keeps the cell in its shape. So that is the beauty of geocell, because it is subjected, each cell in the screen, you can see that there are like one cell surrounded by like eight other cells, and there is this pressure coming from all these surrounding cells, and there is pressure from the internal soil which is filled. So because of this confinement effect, it acts like a mat foundation for any kind of load which has to be supported, and more importantly for cyclic loads, because it has excellent resilient properties, and at the same time it has like capacity to withstand a lot of cyclic loads because of its shape as well as structure. And the material used for creating few meters of this geocell reinforced soil is much, much less, because mostly you are using soil and only geosynthetic material as only the cover. So the initial work, my initial work, first paper was published in 1998 in Geotextiles and Geomembranes. This has taken clues from the Royal Military College of Canada, work of Professor Bathurst and my supervisor, Professor Rajagopal. They have tried to use, They have tried to use these geocells they have used geocells to reinforce soil, and then they have tried to develop an equation for cohesive strength of geocell layer in terms of the confinement. The confinement can be quantified easily by using rubber membrane theory, which is proposed by Henkel and Gilbert. Just give me one second. Extremely sorry about that. So the Henkel's and Gilbert's theory is based on the fact that the whole system works like a thin cylinder subjected to internal pressure, and you can use the hoop stress theory to compute this confining stress from the axial strain on the walls of the geocell, and you can use that to calculate the cohesive strength using Moore Coulomb theory. It's a very simple theory extended to multiple geocells by me at IIT Madras. And then my work was on geocell supported embankments. Embankments are used very extensively in transportation applications because most of the railway and road embankments are built on different types of soils, which may not be having enough subgrade modulus and shear strength to withstand repeated loading and cyclic loading from the vehicles. In such case, we have problems of excessive settlements and bearing capacity failure of these embankments, which we typically see in our Indian roads. A lot of embankment failures which will be happening in the monsoon season. So in such situation, you can actually have geocells as one of the very attractive solutions. And I have done this work in a large steel tank of IIT Madras, where I have created soft clay foundation to such a softness that if you drop a stone, it will just go inside the subgrade. So that kind of a soft soil, and on that a geocell layer, and there is an embankment constructed and tested. So this kind of an experiment needs 1 month for one test, because the soil has to consolidate and it's a huge tank, and there was a lot of non-technical support required for building these kind of models. And I'm thankful to both my supervisors, Professor Rajgopal and Krishnaswamy, to support this entire project. And we could, in a 5 years duration, I could do a lot of testing on these embankments and could come up with some very, very interesting results. Like, this is a typical experiment where you create the soft soil by taking soft clay and mixing with a lot of water, then consolidating it for enough time until it attains uniform stress condition inside, and then create geocells using, that time there were no ready-made geocells available in the market, so we created geocells using these planar geogrids. Both biaxial and uniaxial grids, and filled this clay sand inside, compacted this layer, and then created embankment and tested in those conditions. So this was the first comprehensive PhD thesis on geocells published from India, and later many theses followed. Most importantly, Professor Dash, Sujit Kumar Dash, and Professor Sirish from IISc, and Amarnath recently, and many more. And some of the important results we obtained when we supported these embankments on geocells was, like in one picture you are seeing to your right, when we change the aspect ratio of geocells, which is the height to diameter ratio of the geocells, you see that the optimum settlement is occurring at when your aspect ratio is about 1, which is a very important result, and we could actually use it for many field applications in a later date. So you can see that when you change the aspect ratio, the performance also changes, and with the change in the material and other things, we could actually quantify the strength and stiffness of the geocell reinforced soil. It's a very primitive method. I must admit that it is a very, very simple method based on experiments and empirical equations, but definitely it has entered many geocell manufacturing companies manuals, and that was the starting point for developing these quantitative strength stiffness envelopes for geocell reinforced soil. And then coming to my work on retaining walls, a geocell retaining wall is a very beautiful structure. It looks beautiful, it performs beautiful, and it is very stable against earthquake conditions because of its own stability of width at the base. If you see, you don't need any extra facing in case of geocell retaining walls. Your stacks of geocells themselves can act as facing. And since it is a very flexible structure with no connection between these stacks, any small movement at any location or elevation will only be restricted or contained within that layer, and all other layers will still be intact. So we have done a lot of work on the seismic response of these geocell retaining walls in the shaking table available at IISc. And I would only like to show this slide where you can use these geocell walls for advantage in building retaining walls in transportation applications. In the first figure, you see that you want to extend an available road. You want to extend this slope to a certain more distance. So you can use a geocell retaining wall and fill, and then this can be very, very good way of creating this extension, because the modulus of geocell wall is sufficient that it can arrest the slope stability as well as provide entire support to this fill area, which is creating active earth pressure on the wall. At the same time, if you want to cut the existing road, then also you can support the cut portion with geocell wall so that you can arrest the slope stability, which will be possible because of the driving forces, extra driving forces generated due to the loss of passive resistance from the left side of this slope. So these kind of applications are possible. You can go back and Google geocell retaining walls. You will see like thousands of case studies where geocell retaining walls are used, are being used extensively all over the world for various applications. So in our lab, we could construct these geocell retaining walls using very cheap materials like geonets, and even PVC was used because we want to bring down the strength of geocell or scale down the strength of the geocell to laboratory model test scale, so that when we use the scaling factors, it matches with the strength and modulus of the prototype geocells used in the field. So you can see this geonet made geocells constructed retaining wall, and there is this surcharge pressure applied. This is the laminar box of the shaking table where you apply seismic forces. So these are PVC geocells. It's very interesting work done by my student Manju. And in this, we have used simple PVC sheets to create geocells, and the connections were made. Usually in field, we use ultrasonic bonding to make the connections, but here we have used these photo lamination technique, like how you laminate your photograph to create these bonds. And it's very interesting to see like how these very simple, very low cost geocells could perform against earthquake loading. In this picture, you see like how a rigid faced retaining wall, where you have stacks of steel panels used as facing, complete rigid faced wall. And then you have this geocell faced wall. If you plot horizontal displacement versus elevation, geocell wall, which is made of PVC, can give you better strength than a steel wall made a rigid faced wall. This is possible because you have an extended base in case of geocell wall, unlike your rigid faced wall whose base width is very minimal and it is a kind of a panel which just supports the backfill soil. Even when you see two different types of PVC and HDPE also we have tested, and we have come up with some very interesting results on like the seismic resistance capacity of these geocell walls, because the entire seismic resistance is derived by the shape of the geocells rather than their strength. This is what is the main contribution from this work. And coming to the geocell reinforced roads, I already explained to you the original geocell development was based on transportation applications. And the main feature which is attractive for geocell reinforced walls is their capacity to contain the stresses which are coming from the cyclic loads of the moving vehicles. Since you have a basalt geotextile layer or a geogrid layer below the geocell, it also acts like a separator. And the soil, you can fill cohesionless soil or aggregate or even sometimes cement. And the soil inside these cells provides this additional confinement and contains the lateral stresses so that there is no outward movement of the soil which is confined in the cells. At the same time, it derives additional upward resistance from the basalt geocell geotextile layer. So when you lay these geocells on the road and you fill it with soil, and you can immediately move the heavy duty vehicles on these roads because you don't have any waiting time here. There's no consolidation which is happening. It just provides immediate support. So very quick, rapid solution for creating roads. And these roads are mostly maintenance free. And we also have conducted some repeated load tests on geocell reinforced unpaved roads. This work was done by my student Asha, and 5 years of very good amount of work on the repeated load capacity of geocells in both model tests and also huge cyclic traction tests. So this is, these are some results from the repeated load test. You can see that the, compared to unreinforced payment, your geocell reinforced payments have very less plastic settlement, which means most of the settlement which is coming in this case is elastic and can be recovered immediately after the passage of vehicle. And then these are the huge cyclic traction tests. These are like 300 mm by 600 mm samples reinforced with geocells. And you can very clearly see the effects of, in case of geogrid reinforced soil, you have this necking which is happening at different levels of soil. Whereas if you have cell, then your deformations are uniform. There is no, absolutely no lateral deformation, because it's a very stiff material which is holding this soil against the cyclic loads. And we have also conducted some field tests, very simple field tests, where we have created these geocell layers in front of our main building of IASC and created very soft soil subgrade, and then made these geocells and ran vehicles on these geocell roads. And we could come out with the traffic benefit ratio of the geocells and also the number of load cycles a geocell supported road takes compared to unreinforced. If you see an unreinforced road fails within like 25 vehicle passages in the such soft soil conditions, whereas your geocell road takes more than 250 passes and it's still stable, and there is maximum resilience in this kind of geocell reinforced roads. And you, there is another interesting thing found out, is that the pressure bulb, which usually extends below the vehicle, which goes to almost like twice the breadth of the vehicle, sometimes the wheel width, in case of geocell layers, it is restricted to very, very shallow zone, so that you don't have to worry about the strength of the soil which is lying below. This is another important thing which will come into the design of these roads, because we don't have to worry too much about the deeper, softer layers in, when you use geocells. Some case studies by Strata Geotechnics, who were done a lot of work in Karnataka, where the road condition was very bad, and they have laid geocells and created roads which are like working very good. They are mostly, the important aspect of these kind of roads is that they are maintenance free. Otherwise, you have to repair them in every monsoon season, because the condition will become like this. So you can still fill concrete into the geocells, so that you use it for better heavy applications like airfield payments or bullet trains, which will be coming up in our the next decade. Our country will be doing a lot of express corridors using bullet trains. So our scope for these projects is very high, and we can use these geocells in a very versatile manner into different applications, creating embankments and their abutments and high strength pavements and so on. In particular, in Japan and Singapore, a lot of places people have used geosynthetics for stabilizing the railway tracks for high-speed trains, and we are going to use them in the coming decade for our country's dream of high-speed corridors too. And we will find a lot more applications in this direction.
And we can take around last 2-3 minutes.
I am done. So this is my last slide, which shows you can use a lot of innovative techniques. When I have seen that in this same session, there's some paper which is talking about PET bottle geocells. So some people have used these coconut shells and called them cocoa cells. There are a lot of variations. You can use any material. The strength is, I already told you, not coming from the material, but it is coming mostly from the shape of these cells. So there's a lot of environment-friendly cells coming up. And importance is, like, you use only 3 to 5% of the total cost. Initially, it might be slightly expensive than planar geosynthetics, but you save huge amount in your total maintenance cost on the project. And why are they sustainable? Though they are polymers, geocells are very sustainable, and their usage is recommended in most of the green countries around the world, because they save natural resources, they use automatic construction methods, and they lower carbon footprint, they reduce waste, and they are many people are these days using demolition waste from the buildings and many other fly ash and other materials to fill the geocells. So they can be used for reuse of waste material. So they become completely sustainable solutions for many of our infrastructural projects. Thank you so much.